Chapter number 2, Structure of Atom. The existence of atoms has been proposed since the time of early Indian and Greek philosophers, who were of the view that atoms are the fundamental building blocks of matter. According to them, the continued subdivisions of matter would ultimately yield atoms which would not be further divisible. The word atom has been derived from the Greek word atomio, which means uncuttable or non-divisible. This earlier ideas were mere speculation and there was no way to test them experimentally. These ideas remained dormant for a very long time and were revived again by scientists in the 19th century. The atomic theory of matter was first proposed on a firm scientific basis by John Dalton, a British school teacher in 1808. His theory, called Dalton's atomic theory, regarded the atom as the ultimate particle of matter. In this unit, we start with experimental observations made by scientists towards the end of 19th and beginning of 20th century. This established that atoms can be further divided into subatomic particles, that is electrons, protons and neutrons, a concept very different from that of Dalton. The major problems before the scientists at that time were to account for the stability of atom after the discovery of subatomic particles, to compare the behavior of one element from other in terms of both physical and chemical properties, to explain the formation of different kinds of molecules by the combination of different atoms, and to understand the origin and nature of the characteristics of electromagnetic radiation absorbed or emitted by atoms. 2.1 Subatomic Particles. Dalton's atomic theory was able to explain the law of conservation of mass, law of constant composition, law of multiple proportion very successfully. However, it failed to explain the results of many experiments. For example, it was known that substances like glass or ebonite, when rubbed with silk or fur, generate electricity. Many different kinds of subatomic particles were discovered in the 20th century. However, in this section, we will talk about only two particles, namely electron and proton. 2.1.1 Discovery of Electron. In 1830, Michael Faraday showed that if electricity is passed through a solution of an electrolyte, chemical reactions occurred at the electrodes, which resulted in the liberation and deposition of matter at the electrodes. He formulated certain laws, which you will study in class 12. These results suggested that particulate nature of electricity. An insight into the structure of atom was obtained from the experiments on electrical discharge through gases. Before we discuss these results, we need to keep in mind a basic rule regarding the behavior of charged particles. Like charges repel each other and unlike charges attract each other. In mid-1850s, many scientists, mainly Faraday, began to study electrical discharge in partially evacuated tubes known as cathode ray discharge tubes. It is depicted in figure 2.1. A cathode ray tube is made of glass containing two thin pieces of metal called electrodes sealed in it. The electrical discharge through the gases could be observed only at very low pressures and at very high voltages. The pressure of different gases could be adjusted by evacuation. When sufficiently high voltage is applied across the electrodes, current starts flowing through a stream of particles moving in the tube from the negative electrode to the positive electrode. These were called cathode rays or cathode ray particles. The flow of current from cathode to anode was further checked by making a hole in the anode and coating the tube behind anode with phosphorescent material, zinc sulfide. When this rays, after passing through anode, strike the zinc sulfide coating, a bright spot on the coating is developed. The results of these experiments are summarized below. 1. The cathode rays start from cathode and move towards the anode. 2. These rays themselves are not visible, but their behavior can be observed with the help of certain kind of materials which glow when hit by them. Television picture tubes are cathode ray tubes, and television pictures results due to fluorescence on the television screen coated with certain fluorescent or phosphorescent materials. 3. In the absence of electrical or magnetic field, these rays travel in straight lines. 4. In the presence of electrical or magnetic field, the behavior of cathode rays are similar to the expected from negatively charged particles, suggesting that the cathode rays consist of negatively charged particles called electrons. 5. The characteristics of cathode rays do not depend upon the material of electrons and the nature of the gas present in the cathode rays tube. Thus, we can conclude that electrons are basic constituent of all the atoms. 2.1.2 Charge to mass ratio of electron. In 1897, British physicist J.J. Thomson measured the ratio of electrical charge to the mass of electron by using cathode ray tube and applying electrical and magnetic field perpendicular to each other as well as to the path of electrons. Thomson argued that the amount of deviation of the particles from their path in the presence of electrical or magnetic field depends upon 1. The magnitude of the negative charge on the particle greater the magnitude of the charge on the particle greater is the interaction with the electric or magnetic field and thus greater is the deviation. 2. The mass of the particle lighter the particle greater the deflection. 3. The strength of the electrical or magnetic field. The deflection of electrons from its original path increases with increase in the voltage across the electrodes or the strength of the magnetic field. When only electric field is applied, the electrons deviate from their path and hit the cathode ray tube at point A. Similarly, when only magnetic field is applied, electron strikes the cathode ray tube at point C. By carefully balancing the electrical and magnetic field strength, it is possible to bring back the electron to the path followed as in the absence of electric or magnetic field and they hit the screen at point B. By carrying out accurate measurements on the amount of deflections observed by the electrons on the electric field strength or magnetic field strength, Thomson was able to determine the value of E upon ME as E upon ME is equals to 1.758820 into 10 raised to 11 coulomb per kg, where ME is the mass of the electron in kg and E is the magnitude of the charge on the electron in coulomb. Since electrons are negatively charged, the charge on electron is 2.1.3 Charge on the electron. R.A. Millikan devised a method known as oil drop experiment to determine the charge on the electrons. He found that the charge on the electron to be -1.6 into 10 raised to -19 coulomb. The present accepted value of electrical charge is -1.6022 into 10 raised to -19 coulomb. The mass of the electron was determined by combining these results with Thomson's value of E upon ME ratio. Mass of electron is equals to E upon ME is equals to 1.6022 into 10 raised to -19 coulomb upon 1.758820 into 10 raised to 11 coulomb per kg is equals to 9.1094 into 10 raised to -31 kg. 2.1.4 Discovery of protons and neutrons. Electrical discharge carried out in the modified cathode ray tube led to the discovery of particles carrying positive charge, also known as canal rays. The characteristics of these positively charged particles are listed below. First, unlike cathode rays, the positively charged particles depend upon the nature of gas present in the cathode ray tube. These are simply the positively charged gaseous ions. Second, the charge to mass ratio of the particles is found to depend on the gas from which this originate. Third, some of the positively charged particles carry a multiple of the fundamental unit of electrical charge. Fourth, the behavior of these particles in the magnetic or electrical field is opposite to that observed for electron or cathode rays. The smallest and lightest positive ion was obtained from hydrogen and was called proton. This positively charged particle was characterized in 1919. Later, a need was felt for the presence of electrically neutral particle as one of the constituent of atom. These particles were discovered by Chadwick by bombarding a thin sheet of beryllium by alpha particles. When electrically neutral particles having a mass slightly greater than that of the protons was emitted, he named these particles as neutrons. The important properties of these fundamental particles are given in Table 2.1. 2.2 Atomic models. Observations obtained from the experiments mentioned in the previous sections have suggested that Dalton's indivisible atom is composed of subatomic particles carrying positive and negative charges. Different atomic models were proposed to explain the distributions of discharged particles in an atom. Although some of these models were not able to explain the stability of atoms, two of these models proposed by J.J. Thomson and Ernst Rutherford are discussed below. 2.2.1 Thomson model of atom. J.J. Thomson in 1898 proposed that an atom possesses a spherical shape in which the positive charge is uniformly distributed. The electrons are embedded into it in such a manner as to give the most stable electrostatic arrangement. Many different names are given to this model, for example, plum pudding, raisin pudding or watermelon. This model can be visualized as a pudding or watermelon of positive charge with plums or seeds embedded into it. An important feature of this model is that the mass of the atom is assumed to be uniformly distributed over the atom. Although this model was able to explain the overall neutrality of the atom, but was not consistent with the results of later experiments. Thomson was awarded Nobel Prize for Physics in 1906 for his theoretical and experimental investigations on the conduction of electricity by gases. 2.2 Rutherford's nuclear model of atom. Rutherford and his students bombarded very thin gold foil with alpha particles. Rutherford's famous alpha particle scattering experiment is represented in figure 2.5. A stream of high energy alpha particles from a radioactive source was directed at a thin foil of gold metal. The thin gold foil had a circular fluorescent zinc sulfide screen around it. Whenever alpha particles struck the screen, a tiny flash of light was produced at that point. The results of scattering experiment were quite unexpected. According to Thomson's model of atom, the mass of each gold atom in the foil should have been spread evenly over the entire atom, and alpha particles had enough energy to pass directly through such a uniform distribution of mass. It was expected that the particles would slow down and change directions only by small angles and they passed through the foil. It was observed that most of the alpha particles passed through the gold foil undeflected. A small fraction of the alpha particles was deflected by small angles. A very few alpha particles bounced back, that is, were deflected by nearly 180 degrees. On the basis of the observations, Rutherford drew the following conclusions regarding the structure of atom. First, most of the space in the atom is empty as most of the alpha particles pass through the foil undeflected. Second, a few positively charged alpha particles were deflected. The deflection must be due to enormous repulsive force, showing that the positive charge of the atom is not spread throughout the atom as Thomson had presumed. The positive charge has to be concentrated in a very small volume that repelled and deflected that positively charged alpha particles. Third, calculations by Rutherford show that the volume occupied by the nucleus is negligibly small as compared to the total volume of the atom. The radius of the atom is about 10 raised to minus 10 meter, while that of nucleus is 10 raised to minus 15 meter. One can appreciate this difference in size by realizing that if a cricket ball represents a nucleus, then one radius of atom would be about 5 kilometer. On the basis of above observations and conclusions, Rutherford proposed the nuclear model of atom. According to this model, first, the positive charge and most of the mass of the atom was densely concentrated in extremely small region. This very small portion of the atom was called nucleus by Rutherford. Second, the nucleus is surrounded by electrons that move around the nucleus with a very high speed in a circular path called orbits. Thus, Rutherford's model of atom resembles the solar system in which the nucleus plays the role of sun and the electrons, that is, revolving planets. Third, electrons and the nucleus are held together by electrostatic forces of attraction. 2.2.3 Atomic number and mass number. The presence of positive charge on the nucleus is due to the protons in the nucleus. As established earlier, the charge on the proton is equal but opposite to that of electron. The number of protons present in the nucleus is equal to atomic number. For example, the number of protons in the hydrogen nucleus is 1. In sodium atom, it is 11. Therefore, their atomic numbers are 1 and 11 respectively. In order to keep the electrical neutrality, the number of electrons in an atom is equal to the number of protons. For example, the number of electrons in hydrogen atom and sodium atom are 1 and 11 respectively. Atomic number is equals to number of protons in the nucleus of an atom is equals to number of electrons in a neutral atom. While the positive charge of the nucleus is due to protons, the mass of the nucleus due to protons and neutrons. As discussed earlier, protons and neutrons present in the nucleus are collectively known as nucleons. The total number of nucleons is termed as mass number of the atom. mass number is equals to number of protons plus number of neutrons. 2.2.4 isotopes and isobars. The composition of any atom can be represented by using the normal element symbol with superscript on the left hand side as the atomic mass number and subscript on the left hand side as the atomic number. Isobars are the atoms with same mass number but different atomic number. For example, carbon 614 and nitrogen 714. On the other hand, atoms with identical atomic number but different atomic mass number are known as isotopes. In other words, it is evident that difference between the isotopes is due to the presence of different number of neutrons present in the nucleus. For example, considering of hydrogen atom again, 99.985% of hydrogen atoms contain only one proton. This isotope is called protium. Rest of the percentage of hydrogen atom contains two other isotopes. The one containing one proton and one neutron is called deuterium, and the other one possessing one proton and two neutrons is called tritium. The latter isotope is found in trace amounts on the Earth. Other examples of commonly occurring isotopes are carbon atoms containing 6, 7 and 8 neutrons besides 6 protons, chlorine atoms containing 18 and 20 neutrons besides 17 protons. Lastly, an important point to mention regarding isotopes is that chemical properties of atoms are controlled by the number of electrons, which are determined by the number of protons in the nucleus. Number of neutrons present in the nucleus have very little effect on the chemical properties of an element. Therefore, all the isotopes of a given element show same chemical behavior, playing the role similar to the lighter planets. Further, the Coulomb force between electron and the nucleus is mathematically similar to the gravitational force G into m1 m2 upon r square, where m1 and m2 are the masses, r is the distance of separation of the masses and g is the gravitational constant. When classical mechanics is applied to the solar system, it shows that the planets describe well-defined orbits around the sun. The theory can also calculate precisely the planetary orbits, and this are in agreement with an experimental measurement. The similarity between the solar system and the nuclear model suggests that electrons should move around the nucleus in well-defined orbits. However, when a body is moving in an orbit, it undergoes acceleration. So, an electron in the nuclear model describing planet-like orbits is under acceleration. According to the electromagnetic theory of Maxwell, charged particles when accelerated should emit electromagnetic radiation. Therefore, an electron in an orbit will emit radiation. The energy carried by radiation comes from electronic motion. The orbit will thus continue to shrink. Calculations show that it should take an electron only 10⁻⁸ seconds to spiral into the nucleus. But this does not happen. Thus, the Rutherford model cannot explain the stability of an atom. If the motion of an electron is described on the basis of the classical mechanics and electromagnetic theory, you may ask that since the motion of electrons in orbit is leading to the instability of the atom, then why not consider electrons as stationary around the nucleus? If the electrons were stationary, electrostatic attraction between the dense nucleus and the electrons would pull the electrons toward the nucleus to form a miniature version of Thomson's model of atoms. Another serious drawback of the Rutherford model is that it says nothing about the electronic structure of atoms. That is, how the electrons are distributed around the nucleus and what are the energies of these electrons. 2.3 Developments leading to the Bohr's model of atom. Historically, results observed from the studies of interactions of radiations with matter have provided immense information regarding the structure of atoms and molecules. Niels Bohr utilized these results to improve upon the model proposed by Rutherford. Two developments played a major role in the formulation of Bohr's model of atom. These were, first, dual character of the electromagnetic radiation, which means that radiation possesses both wave-like and particle-like properties, and second, experimental results regarding atomic spectra, which can be explained only by assuming quantized electronic energy levels in atoms. 2.3.1 Wave Nature of Electromagnetic Radiation. James Maxwell was the first to give a comprehensive explanation about the interaction between the charged bodies and the behavior of electrical and magnetic fields on a macroscopic level. He suggested that when electrically charged particles move under acceleration, alternating electrical and magnetic fields are produced and transmitted. These fields are transmitted in the forms of waves called electromagnetic waves or electromagnetic radiation. Light is the form of radiation known from early days, and speculation about its nature dates back to remote ancient times. In earlier days, light was supposed to be made of particles. It was only in the 19th century when wave nature of light was established. Maxwell was again the first to reveal that light waves are associated with oscillating electric and magnetic character. Although electromagnetic wave motion is complex in nature, we will consider here only a few simple properties. First, the oscillating electric and magnetic fields produced by oscillating charged particles are perpendicular to each other, and both are perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the wave. Simplified picture of electromagnetic wave is shown in figure 2.6. Second, unlike sound waves or water waves, electromagnetic waves do not require medium and can move in vacuum. Third, it is now well established that there are many types of electromagnetic radiations which differ from one another in wavelength. This constitutes what is called electromagnetic spectrum. Different regions of the spectrum are identified by different names. Some examples are radio frequency region around 10^6 Hz used for broadcasting, microwave region around 10^10 Hz used for radar, infrared region around 10^13 Hz used for heating, ultraviolet region around 10^15 Hz. The small portion around 10^15 Hz is what is ordinarily called visible light. It is only this part which our eyes can see. Special instruments are required to detect non-visible radiation. Fourth, different kinds of units are used to represent electromagnetic radiation. These radiations are characterized by the properties, namely frequency and wavelength. The SI unit of frequency is hertz, after Heinrich Hertz. It is defined as the number of waves that passes a given point in 1 second. Wavelength should have the units of length, and as you know that the SI units of length is meter. Since electromagnetic radiation consists of different kinds of waves of much smaller wavelength, smaller units are used. Figure 2.7 shows various types of electromagnetic radiations which differ from one another in wavelengths and frequencies. In vacuum, all types of electromagnetic radiations, regardless of wavelength, travel at the same speed, that is 3×10^8 meter per second. This is called speed of light and is given the symbol c. The frequency, wavelength and velocity of light are related by the equation. Speed of light is equals to frequency into wavelength. The other commonly used quantity, especially in spectroscopy, is the wave number. It is defined as the number of wavelengths per unit length. Its units are reciprocal of wavelength unit, that is meter inverse. However, commonly used unit is centimeter inverse, that is not SI unit. 2.3.2 Particle nature of electromagnetic radiation, Planck's quantum theory. Some of the experimental phenomena such as diffraction and interference can be explained by the wave nature of the electromagnetic radiation. However, following are some of the observations which could not be explained with the help of even the electromagnetic theory of 19th century physics. First, the nature of emission of radiation from hot bodies. Second, ejection of electrons from metal surface when radiation strikes it. Third, variation of heat capacity of solids as a function of temperature. Fourth, line spectra of atoms with special reference to hydrogen. It is noteworthy that the first concrete explanation for the phenomenon of the black body radiation was given by Max Planck in 1900. This phenomenon is given below. When solids are heated, they emit radiation over a wide range of wavelengths. For example, when an iron rod is heated in a furnace, It first turns to dull red and then progressively becomes more and more red as the temperature increases. As this is heated further, the radiation emitted becomes white and then becomes blue as the temperature becomes very high. In terms of frequency, it means that the frequency of emitted radiation goes from a lower frequency to a higher frequency as the temperature increases. The red color lies in the lower frequency region, while blue color belongs to the higher frequency region of the electromagnetic spectrum. The ideal body, which emits and absorbs radiations of all frequencies, is called a black body, and the radiation emitted by such a body is called black body radiation. The exact frequency distribution of the emitted radiation from a black body depends only on its temperature. At a given temperature, intensity of radiation emitted increases with decrease of wavelength, reaches a maximum value at a given wavelength, and then starts decreasing with further decrease of wavelength, as shown in figure 2.8. The above experimental results can't explain satisfactorily on the basis of the wave theory of light. Planck suggested that atoms and molecules could emit energy only in discrete quantities and not in a continuous manner, a belief popular at that time. Planck gave the name quantum to the smallest quantity of energy that can be emitted or absorbed in the form of electromagnetic radiation. The energy of a quantum of radiation is proportional to its frequency and is expressed by equation E is equals to Planck constant into frequency. The proportionality constant H is known as Planck's constant and has the value 6.626 × 10⁻³⁴ joules second. With this theory, Planck was able to explain the distribution of intensity in the radiation from black body as a function of frequency or wavelength at different temperatures. Photoelectric effect. In 1887, H. Hertz performed a very interesting experiment in which electrons were ejected when certain metals were exposed to a beam of light, as shown in figure 2.9. The phenomenon is called photoelectric effect. The results observed in this experiment were, first, the electrons are ejected from the metal surface as soon as the beam of light strikes the surface. That is, there is no time lag between the striking of light beam and the ejection of electrons from the metal surface. Second, the number of electrons ejected is proportional to the intensity or brightness of light. Third, for each metal, there is a characteristic minimum frequency. V0, that is also known as threshold frequency, below which photoelectric effect is not observed at frequency greater than threshold frequency. The ejected electrons come out with certain kinetic energy. The kinetic energies of these electrons increase with the increase of frequency of the light used. All the above results could not be explained on the basis of laws of classical physics. According to Litter, the energy content of the beam of light depends upon the brightness of the light. In other words, number of electrons ejected and kinetic energy associated with them should depend on the brightness of light. It has been observed that though the number of electrons ejected does depend upon the brightness of light, the kinetic energy of the ejected electrons does not. For example, red light of any brightness may shine on a piece of potassium metal for hours, but no photoelectrons are ejected. But as soon as even a very weak yellow light shines on the potassium metal, the photoelectric effect is observed. The threshold frequency for potassium metal is 5×10⁴ Hz. Einstein was able to explain the photoelectric effect using Planck's quantum theory of electromagnetic radiation as a starting point. Shining a beam of light on a metal surface can therefore be viewed as shooting a beam of particle, the photons. When a photon of sufficient energy strikes an electron in the atom of the metal, it transfers its energy instantaneously to the electron during the collision and the electron is ejected without any time lag or delay. Greater the energy possessed by the photon, greater will be transfer of energy to the electron and greater the kinetic energy of the ejected electron. In other words, kinetic energy of the ejected electron is proportional to the frequency of the electromagnetic radiation. Since the striking photon has energy equal to hv and the minimum energy required to eject the electron is hv0, then the difference in energy is transferred as the kinetic energy of the photoelectron. Following the conservation of energy principle, the kinetic energy of the ejected electron is given by the equation 2.7. HV is equals to HV0 plus 1/2 mv square, where me is the mass of electron and v is the velocity associated with the ejected electron. Lastly, a more intense beam of light consists of large number of photons. Consequently, the number of electrons ejected is also larger as compared to that in an experiment in which a beam of weaker intensity of light is employed. Dual behavior of electromagnetic radiation. The particle nature of light posed a dilemma for scientists. On the one hand, it could explain the blend satisfactorily, but on the other hand, it was not consistent with the known wave behavior of light, which could account for the phenomena of interference and diffraction. The only way to resolve the dilemma was to accept the idea that light possesses both particle and wave-like properties, that is, light has dual behavior. Depending on the experiment, we find that light behaves either as a wave or as a stream of particles. Whenever radiation interacts with matter, it displays particles-like properties in contrast to the wave-like properties, which it exhibits when it propagates. This concept was totally aligned to the way the scientists thought about matter and radiation, and it took them a long time to become convinced of its validity. It turns out, as you shall see later, that some microscopic particles like electrons also exhibit this wave particle quality, wave particle duality. 2.3.3 Evidence for the quantized electronic energy levels. Atomic spectra. The speed of light depends upon the nature of the medium through which it passes. As a result, the beam of light is deviated or refracted from its original path as it passes from one medium to another. It is observed that when a ray of white light is passed through a prism, the wave with shorter wavelength bends more than the one with a longer wavelength. Since ordinary white light consists of waves with all the wavelengths in the visible range, a ray of white light is spread out into a series of colored bands called spectrum. The light of red color, which has longest wavelength, is deviated the least, while the violet light, which has the shortest wavelength, is deviated the most. The spectrum of white light that we can see ranges from violet at 7.50 into 10 to 14 Hz to red at 4 into 10 to 14 Hz. Such a spectrum is called continuous spectrum. Continuous because violet merges into blue, blue into green, and so on. A similar spectrum is produced when a rainbow forms in the sky. Remember that visible light is just a small portion of the electromagnetic radiation. When electromagnetic radiation interacts with matter, atoms and molecules may absorb energy and reach to a higher energy state. With a higher energy, these are in an unstable state. For returning to their normal energy state, the atoms and molecules emit radiations in various regions of the electromagnetic spectrum. Emission and absorption spectra. The spectrum or radiation emitted by a substance that has absorbed energy is called an emission spectrum. Atoms, molecules, or ions that have absorbed radiation are said to be excited. To produce an emission spectrum, energy is supplied to a sample by heating it or irradiating it and the wavelength of the radiation emitted. As the sample gives up, the absorbed energy is recorded. An absorption spectrum is like this photographic negative of an emission spectrum. A continuum of radiation is passed through a sample which absorbs radiation of certain wavelengths. The missing wavelength, which correspond to the radiation absorbed by the matter, leave dark space in the bright continuous spectrum. The study of emission or absorption spectra is referred to as a spectroscopy. The spectrum of the visible light, as discussed above, was continuous as all wavelengths of the visible light are represented in the spectra. The emission spectra of atoms in the gas phase, on the other hand, do not show a continuous spread of wavelength from red to violet, rather they emit light only at specific wavelength, with dark spaces between them. Such a spectra are called line spectra or atomic spectra because the emitted radiation is identified by the appearance of bright lines in the spectra. Line emission spectra are of great interest in the study of electronic structure. Each element has a unique line emission spectrum. The characteristic lines in atomic spectra can be used in chemical analysis to identify unknown atoms in the same way as fingerprints are used to identify people. The exact matching of lines of the emission spectrum of the atoms of a known element with the lines from an unknown sample quickly establishes the identity of the latter. German chemist Robert Bunsen was one of the first investigators to use line spectra to identify elements. Elements like rubidium, cesium, thallium, indium, gallium, and scandium were discovered when their minerals were analyzed by spectroscopic methods. The element helium was discovered in the sun by spectroscopic method.